Good morning. My name is Tom Collins. If we've not met, I'm the Executive Director and President of the Barnes Foundation, and it is really my pleasure to welcome you this morning, you, the few, the proud, those who already filed their taxes, those who are not planning to celebrate Easter, and those who have finished your grading. It's my pleasure to welcome you this morning to the symposium that was organized by my very talented colleague, Martha Lucy, who is Deputy Director of Education and Public Programs here at the Barnes Foundation, in conjunction with the exhibition Person of the Crowd, which is on view here at the Barnes through May 22nd. Just one part of an extremely varied project that includes a film series, lectures, adult education courses, themed city walking tours, billboard and street poster installations, and performance art throughout Philadelphia. This symposium foregrounds one of the exhibition's most insistent and arguably most relevant sub-themes, the politics of public space. I would just point out that all of those programs I just described are well articulated in this handout, which is available here and in the exhibition space. And all of this is also updated in real time on our dedicated website, which is personofthecrowd.org. I want to thank Martha for her indispensable contribution to this larger menu of institutional offerings. I'd also like to acknowledge the masterful organizational skills of our education colleague, Aaliyah Palumbo, who put all of this together, as well the efforts of our AV team, which has made live streaming happen, and to me that still seems like magic. I know that's sad, but nonetheless it seems like magic to me, so this program is being live streamed. Personally, I've infrequently been as excited by a lineup of speakers as I am this morning, and I want to thank Bridget Alsdorf, Man Bartlett, Andre Dombrowski, Tom McDonough, Doreen St. Felix, and Angela Washko for joining us. Unfortunately, our friend Janet Wolf was unable to make it due to illness.
Should I use? Good morning. I need to apologize for some of you were here at 9, I hear, and I'm not sure what happened. So I'm sorry about that. I know it's hard to get here even at 9:30. I would also like to thank all of those people that Tom thanked. I'm not going to list them again, but I will add to that my mother-in-law, who is here, who I forced to come. Okay. The concept of the flaneur, a social type meaning idler or stroller, is now almost 180 years old. It can be hard to get your head around the fact that this type even has an origin, that there was a time when leisurely, aimless strolling in the city was a novel experience. But if you listen to Edgar Allan Poe's story, Man of the Crowd, written in 1840, you get a sense of how new this experience of seeing and watching throngs of people out in public really was. And I'm just going to read you a passage from the story. He is, the narrator is sitting in the window of a London hotel cafe and sort of watching people, and he says, at this particular period of the evening, I had never before been in a similar situation, and the tumultuous sea of human heads filled me, therefore, with a delicious novelty of emotion. I gave up, at length, all care of things within the hotel and became absorbed in contemplation of the scene without. At first, my observations took an abstract and generalizing turn. I looked at the passengers in masses and thought of them in their aggregate relations. Soon, however, I descended to details and regarded with minute interest the innumerable varieties of figure, dress, air, gait, visage, and expression of countenance. 2 decades later, Baudelaire famously elaborated this new social type in his essay, The Painter of Modern Life, describing the flâneur as the quintessential modern figure, a detached observer who embraces the fleetingness of it all. Baudelaire articulated a new mode of vision, one that was mobile, aimless, and fragmented, and went on to identify flânerie as the engine of an art movement that was beginning to take root around him and which would later become known as Impressionism. The flâneur became an essential figure for later philosophers and sociologists in their attempt to describe the modern experience. Scholars like George Simmel and Walter Benjamin, who connected the flâneur to the rise of capitalism. In the 1980s, this quintessential 19th century figure of modernity began to be deconstructed. Who was the flâneur, really? Who exactly are we talking about? In her pioneering essay, The Invisible Flâneus, Janet Wolfe, who Tom mentioned, was the first to point out that the 19th century flâneur figure could only be male, since women were largely excluded from the public sphere. This meant, then, that the seminal writings describing the modern experience, those of Benjamin, Simmel, Marshall Berman, were only accounting for the experience of men. And Wolfe argued for a feminist sociology of modernity to supplement these texts. And there were issues of class to be addressed. After all, to be a flâneur, one had to have not only the time, but the freedom of unchecked social and geographic mobility. At the same time, scholars like Linda Nochlin and Laura Mulvey had begun to theorize the power embedded in the very act of looking. Work on the flâneur flowed together with theories of the male gaze. Of course, important work on the topic of the 19th century flâneur continues, and you are going to hear some of this work today in talks by two of the best scholars in the field. Andre Dombrowski asks, how did the flâneur, he's talking about the 19th century flâneur, a figure with excess time on his hands, fare during this historical moment that was about efficiency and regularization? Bridget Alsdorf explores the phenomenon of the gawker, another type of looker in the 19th century, and draws out this figure's relationship to the flâneur. The flâneur is invariably understood as an extinct species from the 19th century. This is largely thanks to Benjamin, who in the 1930s argued that with the rise of capitalism, there was no longer any psychological space for the flâneur and his freewheeling ethos. Any sense of mystery previously held by the city streets was being squeezed out by capitalism that had ordered and commodified the urban landscape. But this exhibition has shown that capital has not completely squashed the possibility of flânerie as an activity or as a disruptive artistic strategy. The artists in the gallery upstairs all engage somehow with the street or with the crowd, making spectacles of themselves sometimes to address issues as diverse as commodity fetishism, gentrification, gender politics, globalization, racism, and homelessness. Today you'll hear from Tom McDonough about another living artist whose work engages with the life of the street. The French artist Philippe Parreno, whose performances, installations, and recent films are often concerned with the various forms taken by the contemporary crowd. And even if there are no top-hatted figures with monocles walking around our contemporary streets, the issues attached to flânerie, the politics of vision and power and the right to exist in public space are still, of course, very relevant. What are the contemporary race and gender politics embedded in the idea of the urban wanderer? What are the limits of black spectatorship in the contemporary American city? Does the black flâneur exist? Doreen St. Felix will address some of these questions in her talk, Black Mobility on Strange Terrains. How has flânerie changed during the age of the internet and smartphones and social media? Think about the fact that for many of us, the activities of following and wandering now happen more in the digital realm than in the physical one. Angela Washko's talk brings us into this new digital space to explore some of the gender issues that go on in the massive multiplayer video games. Mann Bartlett will discuss the way that technology mediates our contemporary experience as flaneurs in a broader sense. And this is the driving idea between his piece upstairs in the light court that's projected on the ceiling. So we've got, a really interesting lineup of speakers today, a mix of writers and artists and scholars. And it is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Andre Dombrowski. Andre is Associate Professor of the History of Art at the University of Pennsylvania. His 2013 book, Cézanne, Murder and Modern Life, won the Phillips Book Prize. He is currently at work on a new book that explores the relationship between the Impressionist instant and period technologies of timekeeping. So please help me welcome Andre.
And is there a remote, or how do we move the slides? Okay, got it. Wonderful. Thank you, Martha, for that lovely introduction and for organizing this stellar event. It's such an amazing, interesting lineup of speakers. I'm really excited to hear what's about to transpire. And thanks for including me. I'm honored. Tom, congratulations to a stellar and important exhibition. It's a marvelous event, and thanks to you for coming on early on a Saturday morning. And lastly, may I also thank my mother-in-law, please, who lives in St. Louis but is actually in Philadelphia this weekend. But at home, I did not. I offered her that she could come, but she is actually crawled up with a huge 6-inch book that is called The Best American Short Stories or something like that. And we will see, we'll have a big discussion later about who had the better day. My money is on me. Let me work backwards from a work in the exhibition. During an event called Homage to David Tudor at the American Embassy Theater in Paris in June 1961, Robert Rauschenberg created a series of three combines known as his time paintings. Here, numbers 1 to 3, number 2 at center is in the show. Turning the canvases backs towards the audience, Rauschenberg created the works on stage in front of everyone while rendering them at the same time invisible. Here you can see him doing it. A microphone was attached to them instead, so the audience could hear Rauschenberg's actions but never know in what they resulted visually. An alarm clock attached to each combine rang after a certain point at which Rauschenberg stopped and carried the work off stage, still hiding it from view. With this deliberate audience frustration, he shifted attention away from the image object to the exact amount of time it had taken him to create it. What Rauschenberg showed and what the audience saw was merely the time of creation and not creation itself. The audience had seen time, if you will. In typical Rauschenbergian fashion, an external anonymous measure, clock time, or what Benjamin would call regularized empty time, had furnished the entire parameters of the creative act. These parameters, 30 minutes, say, were now the very stuff of representation. Vision stood, if not exactly mechanically reproduced, then at least mechanically temporalized. These days, as in the exhibition, the paintings are usually displayed just as Rauschenberg's other combines, and the alarm clocks still figure in them centrally, demanding order of their painterly gesticularity, which they oppose and yet created. How did painting get here? And why did an artist of the early neo-flâneur period of the 1960s chose to integrate the flâneur's diametrical opposite, the modern clock with its harsh accounting of time, so centrally within his representations? How come that an extrinsic regulatory function such as this came to embody the rebirth of the flâneur in the late 20th century? We can also think of Li Mingwei's 1966 100 Days with Lily, right? I'll repeat that, 100 days, you know, kept counting. And all the other pieces in the exhibition organized around calendars and watches and schedules, helping to mark the boundaries between performance and life. These are new flâneurs, perhaps more sensitive to and more expressly critical of the role of social regulation than their 19th century flâneurial predecessors were, who were often so ambivalently political and certainly hardly activists. Why was this late 20th century outspoken flâneur reborn with so many watches in hand? An excursion back into the 19th century and the origins of flânerie and its relationship to industrial timekeeping, with its ever more precise and ubiquitous clocks in town and watches on the body, and an ever greater drive towards universality and synchronicity of time, will furnish, I hope, a part answer to my question. The original flâneur had, in one form or another, died or disappeared in the late 19th century at the hand of the emergence of modern industrial clock time, I believe, and its full implementation, just as Benjamin had proposed that he or she had vanished with the West's full embrace of consumer capitalism, as Martha already mentioned a minute ago, with its total welcome of mass spectacle, the department store, and so on, to which the flâneur's preponderance for the consumption of accidental urban sights and minor events, and not of goods, was no longer a useful trope. The literary figure of the flâneur had been invented in the late 18th and early 19th century, the era of the arcades rather than the department store, to make palatable an exhibitionist form of strolling and window shopping that was hardly commodity-oriented in the way we would conceive it, and quite yet. When the practices of high capitalism, as Benjamin calls them, had become fully ingrained within modern urban cultural practices, the need for the trope of the flâneur had partly disappeared alongside them. I want to add to this line of reasoning that the flâneur lost some of his luster at the hand of time. The flâneur was, after all, upon his literary conception, the consummate figure of a willful luxuriating in time, a partisan of the idea that time wasted is time well spent. Flâneurs lingered, followed, flowed through the urban environment at their own pace. Here is Louis Huard in his 1841 Physiologie du Flâneur, and I quote him, that what makes the human the king of creation is that he knows wasting his time and his youth in all possible climates and seasons. Benjamin added that he is, I quote, the man who walks long, long, and aimlessly through the streets, end quote. There is a special temporality to flânerie, therefore. This talk will show what happened when such a flagrantly unproductive pursuit met in the late 19th century the industrial age's drive to standardize, to eventually universalize time itself, all accumulating, if you will, in a very emblematic event in 1884, when it was recommended to make Greenwich, of course, the prime meridian and the center of universal time. So I take that event as a bit of an epitome, as the sort of death date of the flâneur, as you'll see. The final blow that recasted, if you will, the profligate temporality of the flâneur as pure loss when it once had signified a cultural gain. Let us look once more at some of the illustrations I have brought of 19th century flâneurs, some very well-known ones, and it will become evident quickly that they rarely counted a pocket watch among their typical accoutrements. These included the walking stick, the top hat, a cigarette, of course, and binoculars. You know, you wouldn't walk out without those. But a watch chain rarely dangles from a flâneur's vest, even though it had become a sign of bourgeois respectability on most other men of the period. I think if we compare this photograph of Baudelaire and Fontaine's painting of Manet, we can see the difference pretty quickly as to who needed and wanted to carry a watch on their belly and who did not. For the reasons outlined above, the flâneur did not need a watch. There was no technologically sanctioned beginning or end to his actions. Flânerie did not just have no temporal limit, it also had, of course, its imaginary tempo then, different from that of modern life itself. In 1839, Benjamin reminds us, quote him, it was considered elegant to take a tortoise out walking. This gives us an idea of the tempo of flânerie in the arcades, end quote, Benjamin said. And the poet Gérard de Nerval is often said to have walked his lobster, which was actually called Thibault, in public. So you can see this illustrated here. The flâneur demonstrated then a willful slowness, a counter-capitalist speed of visual consumption. He or she thereby displays and exhibitionizes or turns outward, as Benjamin would say, a productive wasting of time. The flâneur made public spectacle of this counter-modern, unproductive temporality. But flânerie was anything but a pure wasting of time. It was hardly boredom or ennui, but full of activity and conquering of urban space at the same time. In 1867, Victor Fournel added the following to our previous definitions of the flâneur. Flânerie means, he said, undertaking interminable expeditions on the streets and promenades without worrying about going somewhere specific or hurrying, stopping at every boutique in order to look at the images on the display, at every street corner to read the broadsheets, at every display to finger through secondhand books, end quote. Right? I hope you heard the at every alliteration here. The emphasis here lies on how completely, how fully the flâneur wasted time. The idleness of the flâneur is a demonstration against the division of labor, as Benjamin once again had it, adding that basic to flânerie is the idea that the fruits of idleness are more precious than the fruits of labor. Unquote. The flâneur then made unproductive time productive, and even though there was no real wasted minute in flânerie, all that interminable activity of drifting did not have a real end goal, but to make of time itself a spectacle in the Rauschenbergian sense with which I started. Minutes, hours, days were celebrated in flânerie as wide, subjective, flexible entities, entailing no concrete pursuit of meaning, the exact opposite of the times of precision the modern clock invented parallelly. But this also means that the flâneur had to succumb, I think, eventually, to the power of newly standardized modern time. And this is the argument I'll pursue for the rest of the talk. Let me demonstrate this via an example. The flâneurial times I have described are the ones we find so frequently in Impressionist painting, as Martha also already mentioned, especially those of Gustave Caillebotte, to whose Parisian urban cityscapes I'll turn for the rest of the talk. Here is On the Pont de l'Europe at the Kimball. Impressionism so often focused on the random juxtapositions that the urban environment created, delighting in their composed and precious randomness rather than any potential significance they might carry. The Impressionist instant is about itself, about passers-by moving in or out of one's frame of vision, cut off by the picture, plane positioned at odd angles, looking at things we cannot see ourselves, thus creating formal relationships on canvas rather than meaningful social relationships in urban space. The modern urban environment, in turn, through such Haussmannian emblems as the Pont de l'Europe that spans the tracks north of the Gare Saint-Lazare, had created the perfect framing devices for such interactions through its iron glass architectural forms. The iron trusses and railings turning the urban world always into so many framed pictures ready for the flaneur's brief inspection. Yeah. Hope you can see pretty quickly what I mean by all those pictures always created by the inside the image. Cabot was the master of this aesthetic. With Degas, perhaps, here's Place de la Concorde, of the instant that was never quite as quickly painted as Monet's and those of the other Impressionists, yet still full of visual accidents. If there was meaning in the modern urban environment for Cabot, it was always lodged simply in these brief seconds of overlap and rupture with no firm base of meaning or truly extensive temporal implications. In Cabot's paintings, the encounter between flaneur and modern time is perhaps staged in its most dramatic and its most overt form. Here's the flaneur of all flaneurs, anonymous, face turned away from us and towards the spectacle of the station with its incoming and outgoing trains, dressed in dark uniform clothes, top hat on, resembling the figure leaving the picture at left, but still clearly distinguished as a type from the working class man behind him, who has actually stopped to linger and look at the trains for a longer period of time. He has sort of really paused and interrupted his day, while the flaneur, he has only been sort of stopped in his tracks to take in that sight. And I want to make that distinction meaningful as we go forward. And this is actually quite the same in the related picture Cabot did of the same scene, where we have a very similar dynamic of the working class figure here leaning against the railing, watching over a longer period of time, while the more flaneurial figure over here, and obviously that relationship he has with the woman behind him and so on, is very ambiguously staged. But part of what's going on here, I think, is him stopping to see and watch a train coming in and out, right? That's one of the possible readings of why he's turning his head to the left, right? But again, those two temporal relationships to the site, I think, are meant to be seen as different and compared to each other. What the paintings show us is the direct comparison then between the two deeply modern temporalities I have been sketching, that of the flaneur and that of modern transport and industry at the station. Cabot annexed the Gare Saint-Lazare and modern transport more generally to his aesthetic cause in order to compare his painted flaneurial moments to another set of temporal indications that surrounded him at this particular site, and especially, I think, at this site. At Saint-Lazare, he would have encountered a fixation on being on time, emblematized by the proliferation of clocks, signals, schedules, and the eventual establishment of a synchronized time specific to French train commerce in the 1870s based on Parisian time. Then that debate over the implication of such a synchronized instant went under the headline of the unification of time, or the unification of the hour, l'unification de l'heure, and in French, of course, heure means both hour and time, so it has that double meaning. And that synchronization or unification was first tested publicly in the 1870s and 1880s when Cabot is at this site. Was not to be actualized, however, largely until the 1890s. By this phrase, right, the unification of time was meant the telegraphic synchronization of the major Parisian public clocks, which soon set a time for the entirety of the French railroads on top of the various local times, it did not always fully override. An idealization and systematization of time through technology that no single clock had yet achieved on its own, no matter its actual powers of precision. This ideal of the unified time implied that potentially all clocks could tick in networked unison, would coordinate and proffer the same time to the inhabitants of the modern metropolis. And I want you to start hearing the social ideal behind this, right? That we all agree on a specific nowness, that we all agree on how long it is, when it takes place, that we do things at the same time through this technologically induced sense of nowness. And I hope you're also starting to hear the kind of counter-flaneurial ideal in that, right? And the sort of slow choking of the flaneur's temporality that this engenders. Back then, such a unified time zone stood apart from the daily usage of time that surrounded it, often by up to 30 minutes, right? So the flaneur's time could be 30 minutes off the times at the stations here, at least until living by it became law or legal French time, which happened on March 1891 when French officially decreed Parisian time to be national time. What the French did when they were asked to adopt Greenwich Mean Time is a story for another day, and they came up with the funniest proposal. Actually, the French lived for 25 years under what's known as Parisian time, which was 9 minutes and 21 seconds distanced from Greenwich time. So it was actually Greenwich time, but not called that. And it had become this kind of temporality, this more abstracted form of clock time, second nature by this point, as it did in the West during the early decades of the 20th century. And in the Caillebotte, I think the flaneur here, flaneurial bourgeois figure, is partly looking at that process, right? Looking at the station and looking at that new temporality. Give you the picture back. Here's Monet writing in 1877. If you would like to visit Caillebotte without me at 3:30 precise, he writes, he will be at home, 77 Rue Miromesnil, and would be happy to receive you. Monet wrote to his client Georges de Beaulieu in late December 1877, italicizing the word precise, thereby drawing attention to the increased value his culture placed on punctuality. We have a lot more Monet letters, so I'm using his rather than Caillebotte's as an example here for one's own personal scheduling habits as they changed in accordance. This is the first time that Monet made such an intense demand for sheer promptness in the letters that have come down to it. It's the first time that he says, please be precise in your arrival. Indeed, judging by his entire correspondence, Monet began to organize his daily life in 30-minute intervals, which were then known as heurettes, small hours. Small-scale hours, diminutive hours, if you will, rather than hourly ones around this very period in his life. So what I mean by that is that Monet started in the late 70s, when Caillebotte is painting here, no longer to ask people, come to my studio between 11 and 1, and then I'll have lunch from 1 to 3, and so on, but he's actually writing, come between 11:30 and 1, and then I'm closing shop until 2:30, and then come back between 2:30 and 4, right? And so the time spans by which one is organizing one's life become ever shorter, right? And he's not yet organizing his life by 15-minute intervals, which is sort of, I think, how we organize, at least I am. And that would, I think, have to wait another while. So the half hour is the time frame here. Such minutiae, you might say they are minutiae, of one's daily schedule may not mean much and may hardly have spilled over directly into the Impressionists' acts of painting. But taking the train from Saint-Lazare shaped their temporal horizons, I think, and stretched and regulated their sense of time, including when they painted. As germane as such shifts in locution may have been to Caillebotte's and Monet's daily scheduling, paintings had, of course, no need to be on time in the same manner that the railway and its passengers did. But if we take the demand for punctuality bequeathed to us from the beginning of coordinated mass transit more literally, as the perfected relationship between time and place, or the unqualified actualization of place in time, then the connections will hopefully become a little clearer. Let me actually give you that back. For what being on time pledges, on being on time, the very preposition on or a, as in a, l'heure, says so expressly, is the ideal union of space and time, even the promise of a place that exists on top of time itself. For the Impressionist picture, the manufacture of the spatio-temporal ideal was a productive signifier of time. One could even say that the Impressionists operated more vigilantly under the logic of being on time, internal to the act of painting, than any other group of painters before them, as opposed to all the external pressures painters had to live with in the period, such as salon submission deadlines or the simple arrival of the darkness of night. Determining, these are their challenges, right? The right place and the right time of painting, snatching the proper impression from everyday life at the proper moment, and stopping depiction just in time to leave the painting in its somewhat haphazard look. For the Impressionists, and perhaps for no one more so than Caillebotte, composing implied impeccable timing. At the core of the Impressionist challenge to the prevailing pictorial norm was, after all, this coordination of various temporal parameters into coherent artworks, the suitable instant, the restless look, the appropriately paced painterly gesture, as well as the time implied by the actions depicted, all of this centering around the flâneur here at the center of the picture. Caillebotte went to paint at Saint-Lazare then in order to correlate these two competing temporalities, I think, the Impressionist flâneurial instant and the time newly invented for and newly systemic to modern railway travel and other aspects of city life and business. In Caillebotte's lifetime, the Gare Saint-Lazare, of course, had expanded quite exponentially. From a single line station in the 1830s, it had successively grown to include more and more tracks, eventually serving most of Normandy and the northwestern Parisian suburbs. In his paintings, Caillebotte, here are the two again together, and his figures always hovered above this now extensive site, watching its activity. Caillebotte sketched and started painting while trains came by and crowds of passengers passed. Yet he decided on a scene nonetheless that made his flâneur respond directly to the times below. We must presume the flâneur at the center of the painting has stopped to watch a train's arrival and departure. He thereby made a group of paintings whose iconography and sense of painterly urgency was deeply affected by the train's routes and schedules in and out of Saint-Lazare. In fact, those schedules are the reason for the pose in the picture, right? And I think we have to acknowledge that. Even though we hardly see them directly and only through small signs like a bit of steam and tiny locomotives seen framed as I've described it. If you will, that's the action that have stopped the flâneur in his tracks. Pun very much intended. By the 1870s, as part of this constant updating of infrastructure at the station and in Paris as a whole, the idea of a unified time took hold, and differences in minutes and even in seconds started to matter as never before. So the opposition to flâneurial time really coming to the fore, if you will, in these decades. Such developments pushed the instant into an ever more prominent place collectively and culturally, preparing it as and for representation, which is where Caillebotte could pick it up halfway, if you will. The station had prepared for Caillebotte a certain look, a certain function and meaning of the instant that he was ready, that was ready to be adopted by him, if you will. He didn't invent his own instants, he partly cited them. It's quite astonishing, just to give you a bit more background, to realize quite how many decades it took to establish unified time in Paris and in France, namely the decades that stretched between the 1870s, some earlier experiments included, and the turn of the last century. Before this effort, many median local times functioned simultaneously throughout France, as each city and geographic area set its time according to the sun's passing above that site's meridian line. Those times were, by the early 19th century, averaged to what I called median local times, right? So there had already been a certain standardization, but time was still averaged to a specific site. This measurement furnished a specific local noon, if you will, not always exactly, but close to what was then called midi vrai, or midi du soleil, right? The real noon, the actual noon at a specific setting. The result was that there existed a time difference in France in the time when the flâneur is at its height of more than 45 minutes between the local time in Brest and the local time in Nice, okay? Just keep that a bit in mind. The various systems, and here are just some of the technical illustrations from the period that I'll visually bore you with for a few minutes before Kai Butler appears. To achieve this, we're all based on electric time regulators and their multiple dependent clocks, which were held briefly in their forward motion until they all reach the desired time provided by the regulator clock, which at that moment releases them back into action. If that makes sense as a system, pretty straightforward. With ingredients such as horloge mère, mother clocks, and horloge réceptrice, or as one commentator phrased it, horloge directrice, director clocks, and horloge secondaire, secondary clocks. The multiplicity in denomination itself became an index of the fact that time synchronization or uniformation entailed quite profound hierarchies masking as equality and uniformity, right? There's always a sort of center that dictates its uniformity to its outward network. The Parisian municipality established a committee of scientists to study the issue in 1875, right? So listen to that and the fact that Caillebotte painted the picture we've been looking at in 1876, and it's in the Impressionist show in 77. In 1876, it inaugurated a widely publicized contest among French clockmakers to build four precision clocks for the purpose of unifying Parisian time. The contest concluded in 1877, actually, which is also when Monet is at the Gare Saint-Lazare. So there's a whole nucleus of Impressionist painters at that very site when this happens. And some of the results of this contest and others to the same effect were on display, much lauded at the 78 Paris World's Fair as well. In 1879, the committee, now including none other than Eugène Viollet-le-Duc, received approval from the city to fund 12 what was known as centres horaires dotted throughout Paris that would distribute the observatory's time and keep a synchronized time while the other clocks of Paris would continue to provide their times. These centres horaires were opened in 1880. One still exists today at the Barrière d'Enfer. These are my photos of my pilgrimage there. It's the last one of them surviving, right? But it's the here you have the first, if you will, clock system in Paris where you would expect to have the observatory time given to you and synchronized with another set of clocks, right? And what that did to the uniformation of everyone's individual time, I hope. Is clear. If you're interested in this story, it's been beautifully and elegantly told in a famous book by the Harvard historian of science, Peter Galison, called Einstein's Clocks and Poincaré's Maps, and fabulous read. During these same years, clock synchronization was also attempted by pneumatic means, and the so-called Compagnie Générale des Horloges Pneumatiques opened in Paris in 1879. In March 1880, their main location began dispensing what was known as time services, an event deserving this double page spread in the illustrated newspaper L'Illustration. And in the minds of many Parisians, therefore, time became a product in itself, one of those regularly and mechanically provided amenities of the modern city, like water, gas, and electricity as well. Try to be a flaneur under these conditions in which time is procured in this way. It's a little bit like holding up garlic to a vampire, I think. These years, which coincide, of course, with the principal years of Impressionism, even though the problem had become as critical as it ever would, are marked by a heightened temporal chaos. This is Galison's formulation before the whole thing of synchronized time was finally figured out late in the century. The negotiation of the various times of everyday life, and it's this negotiation, I think, this coming into being of this time that is the ground on which the Impressionist instant could flourish, and the temporality that nourished the Impressionist instant, I want to claim. Was then most acutely felt, of course, during railway travel. When representing Saint-Lazare here at different times, or when painting the instant at Saint-Lazare, as Caillebotte did, he yielded temporal signs that were not exclusively painterly or even natural, but technologically encoded within the site he chose to paint. Indeed, we have to imagine that Caillebotte, when painting his moments of Saint-Lazare, coordinated a host of conflicting actual seconds into one painting, which never quite amounted to being one. The standard local time then in Paris, right, that we've talked about, the various other times provided by the different clocks in Paris, which some ran in accordance with observatory time and others not, the time at the train stations, which were operating on Paris meantime in the 1870s, all of them in France. So if you, in Paris, the observatory matches your station's time, but as soon as you leave, you actually have Paris time at the stations and your local time parallel. But this train time, this Paris mean time, also differed by 5 minutes between the exterior and the interior clocks, what was known as waiting room time and track time, to allow for some wiggle room in the departure schedule. And do I wish we still had this? You know, you had so many less trains missed for me, which means that track time was actually corresponding to Rouen's local time. Okay, so on the tracks in Paris, it was actually at the same time Rouen's local time. And finally, if you will, the time furnished by Caillebotte's pocket watch, Caillebotte time, if you will. Right? So he is actually negotiating all those. Coup d'heure, nothing but a plurality of times. This is how Henri de Parville lamented in 1894 when describing this situation, coup d'heure. So in some sense, this is the last thriving of flaneurial temporality, as I see it. The game of punctuality had never been more complicated and would never be as complicated again than while traveling the railroads in those decades. This is what Flaneur is watching here. The reasons for this temporal tohu vabohu were as follows. We add some more stuff to the list. By the 1870s, the various French railroad companies, which profited, of course, most from a regulated time schema for their operations, had established a time of their own based on Paris mean time provided by the observatory. This meant that except for Paris, where hardly all clocks followed the same time in any case, a double time standard was typical everywhere, right? As I already mentioned. Paris time on the trains and at the train stations versus the various local times in town, resulting in potential differences of nearly 20 minutes between the Heure de la Ville and the Heure de la Gare. So imagine it's 10:40 here right now, right? At 30th Street Station, it's 10:40. Good luck catching your train. Train travel literalized then and materialized time, and time in turn was never more product than when it itself traveled the rails. Time, in fact, was brought along for the ride. I think this is the strangest of all the things the 19th century's craze of technology did, sent along from Paris like other goods, because once a week, a clockmaker traveled the various French routes with a precision chronometer and set the various clocks at the stations with his finger, au pouce, with his thumb. So official time was thus an actual train passenger with everyone else. While time became ever more material and visible in these ways, it also developed a progressively autonomous presence in modern life. As Paris time was literally carried through the country, a pre-established time proffered a standard that separated itself off slowly from previous lived forms of time. As the German media historian Bernhard Siegert would say, time had closed in on itself as an autonomous system. It established norms that granted standardized time communicated between clocks a priority over the relationship between clocks and their individual users. Being on time shifted then not merely semantically, but practically as well. One's daily labor of keeping accurate time accommodated. This is the best caricature I found talking about this process. Here's your flaneurial couple strolling the streets of Paris, and they're coming across one of those newly installed clocks here. And what does presumably he say? Oh, how monotonous it is to see the same time everywhere. Okay? How monotonous it is to see the same time everywhere. And that tells you a bit about the quarrel going on here. What did it mean to create paintings about instants within these shifting temporal conditions at Saint-Lazare? It cannot be coincidental that Caillebotte chose to focus on the brief urban moment just as time standardized around him and when unified time itself became a topic of public debate. The unification of time meant, after all, a certain aestheticization of time, an adherence to modern cultural tastes and preferences rather than natural givens. A unified time enhanced the thingly nature of time, which in turn could, in that spectacularized form, become more easily digestible within the act of painting. What is more, it can be argued that the unification of time and all its material residues inside the train stations pushed Caillebotte to make specific choices about what to paint at Saint-Lazare. Some of his most daring paintings of the group then resulted, like those focusing so exclusively on the encounter between the modern passerby and the modern iron architecture that was the material evidence of time's newfound rationality. As if to demonstrate how fully the formal logic of painting at Saint-Lazare was dependent on the train traffic around him, Caillebotte arrested his imagery at precisely those moments when trains fascinated his subject and even endangered the very place and time of his paintings. When trains passed by, the bridge shook a bit and his body trembled, or steam impeded his field of vision. Painting and viewing painting became partly scheduled and certainly specifically timed events in turn. Caillebotte thus allowed the Impressionist moment to appear as a deduced temporal frame, not an autonomous one, as I've been arguing, producing pictures that rested formally on the temporal schemes by which they had been set up and which they represented. The flaneur's temporality thereby had been superseded, I think. The flaneur is watching a bit helplessly, the very temporality about to undo his favorite temporal non-productive pursuits. The fascination of the paintings, I think, lies in this encounter and the clash between these two incommensurate worlds of time. To conclude, when almost 100 years later, the flaneur reemerged in avant-garde art in the decades of the rise of urban street performance that is the topic of Tom's exhibition, he and she reemerged with that weakness about modern time conquered, with the calendar and the clock having now become a full, even essential part of flânerie. Vito Acconci's following piece, 1969, in which he followed one different random person per day for about 3 weeks until they entered an apartment building, a restaurant, or a cab. In doing so, as he put it, he positioned himself, I quote him, out of space, out of time. My time and space are taken up out of myself into a larger system, he said. The clock and the calendar framed every encounter of this contemporary flaneur, and he had made of them his. And here is his one of his descriptions of one of these encounters. October 25, 10:30 a.m. Christopher Street and Hudson, southwest corner, man in a blue jacket. He walks south on Hudson Street, west side of street. At 10:34 a.m., he enters Golden Rule Liquor Store, lucky him, 457 Hudson Street. At 10:40 a.m., he leaves Golden Rule and walks north on Hudson Street, east side of street. At 10:42 a.m., he turns east on Grove Street, north side of street. At 10:44 a.m., he turns south on Bedford Street, east side of street, and enters First Apartment Building, 90 Bedford Street, end quote. Aconci's flânerie ended at 10:44 in the morning, a time frame that would have meant little to Baudelaire, Poe, and the other 19th century flâneurs who would, I think, have kept walking. Thank you.
It's working. I don't have to unmute it. That's great. Sorry, I'm just gonna get my bearings here. Woo. God, I love a laser pointer. All right, sorry, I'm just gonna situate some things really quickly. All right, thanks so much for having me. Thanks for to Martha, Leah, and Tom, and the Barnes Foundation, and all of the other panelists, and all of you for coming. I am happy to be here as a representative of the digital side of this discourse. So I make performances, interventions, net-based projects, and videos, often inside video game or internet enclave contexts. And more recently, I started making my own video games. I'm also an assistant professor of art at Carnegie Mellon University, so I'm coming in from Pittsburgh. Today I'm going to mostly talk about my works inside the game World of Warcraft and my ways of utilizing that space as a site for performance and responsiveness to the landscape rather than the task or goal or rule-oriented way that game space is typically used. But before I can talk about the nature of my actions inside World of Warcraft, I feel like I probably have a duty to explain a bit more about that game context and what it sort of means to be a cyber flaneur, especially in that sort of context. How many of you have played World of Warcraft? Yeah! Got one! I was not even expecting one, so I can't tell you how excited I am. We'll have a lot more to talk about. How many of you are at least familiar with what World of Warcraft is? Okay. Okay. So this is why I ask, because then I know that I have to give you a little bit more information about what this is. World of Warcraft is a massively multiplayer online role-playing game. Millions of players, log into the game space, divided into servers, and share the space together, doing quests, often to kill things, together, and also participating in a highly social environment. it parallels public space in terms of scale, the representation of the landscape, the ability to run into lots of people in these social spaces that are basically towns. And it differs from public space, not only because it's on a computer screen, but also because of the way that it structurally facilitates exchanges with complete strangers. This is aided by the fact that you're represented by an avatar, and this avatar does not point back to who you are behind the screen. The possibilities for unusual encounters not guided by the rules that we're governed by outside of the screen was something that excited me about earlier versions of the internet, the Web 1.0 internet or the anonymous internet. The internet before we were bound by our identities, before social media connectivity, before our YouTube account says Angela Washko on it. World of Warcraft still maintains elements of that Web 1.0 internet. The element of wonder in wandering the internet without purpose is at the core of the practice of the cyberflaneur described by Evgeny Morozov, and at the core of a lot of the gestures that I produced in the two major projects in WoW that I'll talk about in a moment. This video that you're seeing now, sorry, I won't do that again, ended up being called Chasin Waterfalls, and it was the first time that I actually recorded myself performing, in quotes, because I wasn't seeing it that way at the time, inside of World of Warcraft. I had just been playing the game and decided for a moment that instead of doing a quest or whatever it was I was doing, that I was going to record a video of me trying to jump from the top of a waterfall into the water below and see if I would survive. I fail several times. I die. I resurrect myself. I die again. I resurrect myself again. And then the performance, as I now call it, felt finished when I finally land safely into the water. And in WoW, one of the interesting things about game spaces like WoW is that everything you do to the landscape disappears over time. I can die a million times and come back. I can say something to a group of people, and in a few minutes, the record of those words will be completely gone. These qualities, both the social culture of the space and the ephemeral quality of the environment, led me to make many performances that I no longer use quotes for in the space from 2012 to 2016. The performances, it's important, hopefully it'll be clear to you when I explain the next project, but the performances are coming from a position also of criticality about how women's experiences differ greatly from men's experiences in this space. Just wait till. Okay. I'm gonna go into two of the major long-term projects I completed inside World of Warcraft. So in 2012, my interest in online gaming, performance art, organizing, and collectivity overlapped when I started the Council on Gender Sensitivity and Behavioral Awareness in World of Warcraft. I've been playing World of Warcraft for over 10 years now. I've been playing since the game started. But in 2012, I decided to begin this council as a platform to discuss issues within the community's public communication channels, which had become quite misogynistic, homophobic, and racist on the servers that I've been playing on. As the council, I started to ask questions about inclusivity, entitlement to the space, who gets to ask questions about the community's actions, how players are held accountable for harassment, why women are treated so poorly in the space, and why the politics of everyday life outside of the screen ended up so embedded in exchanges in the fantasy game landscape. You know, we're trolls and whatnot. So after many years of playing the game properly and becoming really a part of the player base, the community, I'm not just sort of dropping in and being like, hey, what can I take from this space to show the art world or something like that, which is, I think, important to the level of access that I have to it. But yeah, so after many, many years of playing the game properly and being a real gamer, as the council, instead of continuing that trajectory of following what the game wanted me to do with my characters, getting more and more better equipment, killing more and more challenging enemies, et cetera, I started going into major towns to talk to players about why the WoW communities, at least on the servers that I played on, had become so exclusionary toward women. LGBTQIA communities and people of color. And that later developed into a focus on asking players to share their understandings or definitions of what feminism meant to them. I started focusing on this after it became apparent that feminism, the term, warranted the most extreme and polarizing responses of any topic I could bring up in this space. At some point in this process, I started capturing video of these conversations and started an archive of them, which started to create a geographically diverse picture of American opinions on feminism, at least from self-identified gamers. Some right away, conversations dove into really delicate and intense subject matter, especially as I mentioned before, the anonymity in the space ends up allowing for an intimacy and a lack of sort of physical world accountability for that intimacy. Because WoW is still relatively avatar hidden, unlike most of the spaces that we now occupy online, it maintains that that anonymity and that intimacy. So here I'm talking to a player, and her avatar name was Chastity, and we talked for 8 hours, and she ends up going into a very, very personal story about sexual assault, which was not something I thought that the council would really be covering as a part of the practice. This was very early on in the process. And that video is online if you're interested. I initially went into the project with a plan to try to change the sexist and racist language used casually inside WoW by rallying people who are also frustrated with the discrimination in the space. However, as I talked to more and more players about it, the reasoning for its presence became increasingly complex, and I realized that trying to change it was not only naively unrealistic at the time, but also a bit colonial in its impulse, me sort of wanting to change this community to speak in a way that I thought was, you know, more acceptable. So my intention shifted away over time from changing to rather trying to understand how it came to be, and also trying to create safe spaces for players to share and discuss their experiences around these issues. One of the many subtopics of the project involved an investigation into why, in more recent years, men have overwhelmingly started to play female avatars in World of Warcraft. Through these conversations, which I always disclose to participants will be presented elsewhere, like here, I began to realize that most of the female avatars that I was talking to were actually played by men. And this hunch was backed by Nikki's 2010 census data, which stated that 55% of the female avatars running around are played by men. And on the other hand, less than 1% of women play male avatars, which is kind of a striking difference. Initially, I thought the whole men playing women phenomenon was kind of interesting and potentially exciting. I imagined that maybe men were playing women because they wanted to experience WoW from the perspective of a woman, or to have some kind of empathetic experience of learning what it's like to play WoW perceived as a woman and constantly being solicited for sexual favors. But I was wrong. Avatar bodies are treated as abstracted objects of desire, at least in this space. Removed from the physical reality of human flesh and the responsibility of having to see the emotional response to being treated like a sex object, even in a casual collaborative battle setting, when I'm not even remotely discussing feminism, I'm just trying to kill this dragon. If it's known that I'm a woman in the space, even if I jump too often or make too many smiley faces, or maybe I say E in a string, if it's assumed that I'm a woman in the space, I become something to project male sexual fantasy and ownership onto in this space. Women often accept this as their scarcity in World of Warcraft is also a benefit in terms of getting to trade their femaleness for preferential treatment in guilds, which are sort of micro communities that are competitive in the game, and also receiving gifts of gold and equipment and so on. With so many men playing female avatars, women actually have to come out as women to be identified as such. Otherwise, they're assumed to be men. So this became a frequent focus in my discussions as the council. I started asking men why they play women. women avatars. And I was surprised to find that this answer was pretty consistent, because I'd rather look at a girl's butt than a guy's butt. That's what he's saying here. And then it happened again and again and again, and I got the same answer over and over again. I have so many screenshots like this. And I was wondering how one line of thinking became so pervasive. It's as if somebody decided all of a sudden and it became an informal rule across all of the servers. Here, a group of us are trying to figure out the origins of that line of thinking. But yeah, I became interested in the social codes produced and enforced that would create this kind of universal canned response. These codes became so ubiquitous across servers that many male players play women as a way to avoid a fear of being perceived as gay by other players. This I found incredibly shocking, that in this fantasy space, we can't even be queer. Like, this would be like, you know, such a horrible thing to run around and have somebody project that onto you. So this player is actually shouting, that's what the red text means. He's shouting to the whole town that he plays women to make it clear that he's not gay. The project had gained a pretty large following in-game, especially on the primary server that I was operating on, and an intentional inclusive guild was created as a part of the regular discussions that we're having in the space. And I've stopped doing this process in the last year, and my biggest hope was that the project could ultimately become a prototype for continued actions by other players. And so this guild that was created was one way that it can sort of continues to operate. I used to have this theory about that I think the political climate has changed so much that, I used to say that I thought that maybe some of the reasoning for the extreme language and extreme exclusivity in this fantasy space was that WoW became a kind of dark, safe space for people who have to perform political correctness in their daily lives outside of the screen because of this lack of real-world accountability in the space. And I thought that perhaps people who are afraid of losing their jobs because of their discriminatory beliefs used WoW as a social space where they could use their increasingly culturally unacceptable language here without consequence. And then we elected Trump. And our recent presidential race, which outed millions of bigoted, homophobic, misogynists, and the unanswered for deaths of many unarmed people of color at the hands of those tasked with protecting them, I think we've returned to a moment where white supremacy is mainstream. And at the same time, I've noticed in sort of the end time of the project that I was doing, that while players seem to be much more compelled to informally police discriminatory behavior and seem to actually be getting better. So I don't know what to make of that, but I do think that, I hope that, I didn't get to elaborate too much on this in this project, but the digital and the physical are entwined so much more than I hope, what was I gonna say? This is real life. Many people in World of Warcraft meet each other and get married. This is not fantasy. It looks like fantasy and it's packaged through fantasy, but people are having really real experiences in this space, and it's so integrated into daily life now, especially as we have handheld devices and whatnot, that we're very rarely not connected to what used to be sort of relegated to a computer screen. So anyway, ubiquitous computing. So in addition to performing this intervention in the game space, I've occasionally brought the performance to live theater audiences, or the process to live theater audiences. The last iteration of this was hosted by Franklin Furnace Archive in New York, and I actually recruited two other players of World of Warcraft to work with me in the game for a year, and then we came together to produce a live performance of the process. And also, if you want to see the long version, where I talk quite a lot about this project, particularly the first 3 years of it, and there are a lot of videos as well, I have an essay called Why Talk Feminism in World of Warcraft, commissioned by Creative Time, which, yeah, is very detailed. Okay, so at the same time that I was operating as the council, I was just spending a lot of time in WoW. And I started another project in which I wandered the landscape in a way that was not encouraged by the developers of the game. After a while of doing this, I started convincing other players to join me and began calling the practice the World of Warcraft Psychogeographical Association. I was really into naming things at the time and institutional legitimacy. So operating under this title, I performed these long wandering drifts throughout underappreciated aspects of the landscape in the game, inviting players to take time off from the game's increasingly structured quest environment and explore with me. This was a 12-hour long version of it. 12 hours, not Vito Conchi time. So I did a 12-hour long live version at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Helsinki, Kiasma, in 2014. And I was surprised that anybody came. On one drift, a player guided me to the in-game shrine designed for a very young programmer who had died, a 19-year-old aspiring programmer at Blizzard. There are very few ways to have a lasting impact on the landscape in WoW, and all of your actions are wiped clean after a certain amount of time. So this monument, sort of referring to something going on outside of the screen, was quite significant. Here, a player asked me to take him to the moon. He was not able to fly, so I helped him out, but we could not go to the moon. On these drifts, I often explore areas of the landscape that are completely inhabited by an artificial intelligence. As the game has expanded, there are many aspects of the landscape that are no longer useful within the leveling trajectories of the player base. The game is much less designed around exploring now. It's much more focused on clicking a button, being transported, going to the next place, fighting something. So I like to go to these formerly very active spaces and now basically abandoned by human player spaces and give the AI something to do, basically. and this is a part of a practice of misplaying games, which is evident in a lot of my work. I also, in this project, try to inhabit a state of environmental responsiveness and openness that shares affinities with psychogeography. So instead of relying on the game's utility model of using the space, I try to come up with games inside of the game in order to create new ways to participate in this massive and also, I think, quirky and very beautiful game space. So trying to find opportunities for play that's more expressive and not as task-oriented, which in WoW is difficult to sort of get people to do in the way that they're incentivized to keep clicking. Here I'm playing a game with someone where we're just walking around trying to find yellow flowers. I'm just going to show a few, I guess, nice looking moments from the drifts. Here I'm letting someone know that our conversation is being projected in a museum, and they're like, wow, sweet. Photo ops. So as often as, I like to show this work too, because as often as I was doing this pretty serious community-based ethnographic work as the council, I was also doing equally as many silly and absurd gestures and performances in the space. And I'm going to show a quick clip from an experiment by the WoW Psychogeographical Association in which I managed to start a scantily clad orc and troll march with other players. And it's important to note that we're walking, like the default in World of Warcraft is to always run, and through this process we've elected to walk. And so we move very, very slowly, and this looks very, very strange in this environment. And then we'll move away from WoW for a second. Can we get more sound on that?
Taz Dingle. Taz Dingle.
Victory or death.
Back, 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 back,
back, back, back, back, back, back,
back, back,
back,
back, back, back, back,
victory or death.
Taz Dingle.
Where we travel from the edge of one continent to the other edge. Okay. Where was I? So what would an artificially intelligent non-human Flaneur look like? Well, in another related body of work, and this is the last work I'm going to talk about, that I've been exploring since 2013, is a project called Free Will Mode. In this project, I put artificial intelligence or simulated humans into situations where they have the opportunity to break free at least of the financial demands of capitalism and then test how they respond to the situation. These experiments are happening inside the 90s PC game, The Sims. And they involve me setting up an architectural context for simulated humans, which is clearly not in line with the game wants you to design. If you play the game properly, then you design houses, and then you get your Sims better jobs, and then you decorate the Sims' houses more nicely, and then you make your Sims have kids, and then you buy bigger, better houses and get better jobs and decorate the houses with more expensive stuff, right? Sounds familiar. and this, to me, seemed so mundane for the most popular game of its time. When it came out, it was the best-selling game of its time. And yeah, so I thought that this said something about our cultural desire for normalcy and control and to watch ourselves and so on. But the environments that I construct force the AI into situations in which they do not have access to something considered standard in the Western capitalistic and domestic sense. And so in this particular work that you're seeing, Survival Rates in Captivity, the fifth Free Will Mode video, I have actually two separate instances of the game The Sims running on two computers at the same time. The architectural setup for both is exactly the same, but on the left channel you have all women Sims, because in at least the first Sims there's a very strict binary, you have women or you have men, and there's not a lot of avatar customization possibilities. But on the left channel you have all women Sims confined to the inside of a house they cannot get out of, but with more than everything they could possibly need. And on the right side, you have a setup of all male Sims confined to the outdoors, but with still food, bathrooms, or outhouses, a pool, and benches. In the Free Will Mode project, I check a box on the interface called Free Will. And doing this allows the Sims to do what they think that they need to do to survive. So they know that they should eat food. They know that they can do that without the human player controlling them. So I click that box, and I relinquish control of the Sims, allowing them to act as they're designed to in their new environments. And all I do is run the camera, so where you're seeing, and once I start the project. This sort of situation also puts the AI into this position of being surveilled performers, responding to the spaces as they're designed to, which ultimately exposes the lack of creativity and overall stupidity designed in their human logic, which you'll see in a second. This is the very beginning of the piece, so they've just sort of entered the spaces, they are exploring them, and I'm gonna advance to what happens 40 minutes into this sort of setup, and you'll see, they sort of start to break down. They want the player to intervene. They don't want to be autonomous anymore, without the guidance of the player, they sort of start to fail to take care of their basic needs. This, if you project humanness onto these figures, this might be a little upsetting. So just remember that they're AI, and we don't respect AI intelligence, so it's okay. Okay. So I didn't get to talk about my work with pickup artists and men's rights activism and the communities embedded in that focus, since it was a bit of an outlier topic for this panel, but I want to give a little plug really quickly for my newest project, or newest in the sense that I've been working on it for 2 years. Because after critiquing and misplaying games for so long, I felt like I wanted to make games. And so I've been very interested in exploring why the utopian, connective, and hopeful aims of the internet devolved into increasingly niche communities with their own very specific languages. I'm sure you've heard the term echo chambers thrown around. And that there are so many toxic, racist, sexist, and homophobic, and very mobilized groups who antagonize people working in social justice online. So I made a game called The Game The Game, through which you interact with a bunch of the most prominent pickup artists or male seduction coaches at a common place for femme-presenting people to be picked up, so the bar. And you sort of are trying to meander through this space, but you keep being sort of interrupted by these different figures who won't let you sort of proceed. All of the dialogue is taken from the pickup artist's actual books and blogs and videos, so I'm not really projecting onto them what they're like, but they sort of speak through themselves and their work. The first chapter was released in the fall at Transfer Gallery in New York, and the full game will be available online soon. And the soundtrack was made by the band Shushu, so there's that too. Thanks so much!
Thank you. That was so interesting and disturbing, and you gave us a lot to think about. it was fascinating. I would now like to introduce Doreen St. Felix, who is a writer from Brooklyn. Her criticism focuses on the intersections and gaps between pop culture, blackness, and language. Her writing has been featured in the New York Times, The New Yorker, Vogue, and many other publications. Currently, she is a music critic at MTV News. So please help me welcome Doreen St. Felix.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me, Martha, Aaliyah, and Tom. I'm very excited to have listened to the talks this morning and also for the talks this afternoon. So this is my clicker. I want to begin with this photo. This is the cover of a later edition of a travel and vacation guide that was published once a year from 1933 to 1964. The guide was alternately called the Negro Motorist Green Book or the Negro Traveler's Green Book before later dropping the word Negro during its last cycles of publication. Victor Hugo Green founded the Green Book. He had spent many years walking the streets of America as an exigency of his occupation. He worked as a mailman. Green understood, experienced, and witnessed the peculiar dramas Black people could find themselves immersed in, walking around or on or inside of this America, especially during the era of Jim Crow legislation. Each edition of the Green Book offered practical tips and techniques for its ideal reader, an adult plagued with a moderate degree of wanderlust and of practical fear of the sundown towns located in his country. Green's intention was to alleviate the, quote, embarrassments black citizens endured when breaking their sterile fields, when showing up in neighborhoods, cities, and towns that they didn't previously know. It should be said that by embarrassments, Green likely meant a range of consequences that would have upset the genteel etiquette of travel writing. These consequences have been, historically, harassment, forced segregation, heckling, hosing, the sicking of dogs, rape, murder, and then the spectacularized murder of lynching. The Green Book was meant to be a solution to a problem, a satirical piece that ran in the crisis, which was the NAACP's newspaper, lampoons very well. And so this is how the piece reads, part of it. Would a Negro like to pursue a little happiness at a theater, a beach, pool, hotel, restaurant, on a train, plane, or ship, a golf course, summer or winter resort? Would he like to stop overnight at a tourist camp while he motors about his native land, quote, seeing America first? Well, let's just see him try. Having studied original issues of this Green Book, the essayist Carvel Wallace said this: there is an obvious irony in the fact that a country that obsessively congratulates itself on its freedoms, even using them as a rationale for foreign military intervention, is so unsafe for its own naturally born citizens that a guidebook, this Negro Motorist Green Book, has to show these citizens where they could safely exist within its borders. It is so ironic that this thing ever had to be published. This talk, called Black Mobility on Strange Terrains, will interrogate the peculiar emergency that is a moving, ambulatory, traveling Black person. There are many sorts of movement a Black American citizen might need to make in a day. They might need to cross the street, they might need to start their car, or they might need to develop an idea, or they might need to flex their creativity. I'm interested in analyzing the performativity of Black movement, of tracking both the conforming and aberrant choreographies Black people have designed in order to placate or intervene on those institutions that infringe on their movement. I will chart choreographies of freedom. To do so, I'll focus on a literary tradition, discussing the works of the poets Phyllis Wheatley and June Jordan, attempting to retrieve their respective geographies. This talk will apply a Black feminist approach to its subject. I'll follow the effects of policing, both systemic policing and social amorphous policing, on Black creativity. I hope to coax out the troubled line between Black utopias and the reality of the country, between promise and peril, and I'm sure that I'll fail. Last year, I wrote an essay called The Peril of Black Mobility, which partly inspired the range of this talk. I'll read an excerpt from it now. Who is the Black flâneur? He or she is a loiterer. The roving that permits white fancy, white whim, white walking in our modern American cities, when observed in us and our children, reads criminal. Some Black wandering the public has grieved. Michael Brown in the middle of the street. Sandra Bland on a road trip. Tamir Rice in the park. Akai Gurley up the stairs. In America's cities, Black bodies stand under many lights, and the effect is not liberating warmth, but that paranoia of surveillance. There are streets you know not to walk down for the particular threats that are built in. It's maddening, incorporating so many fields of vision, planning so many sophisticated routes. To go back to the Green Book, you could interpret the dropping of the word Negro as an act of optimism. You could also interpret the ending of the publication of the guide, which was the same year as the passing of the Civil Rights Act, as another act of optimism, as a signal to a sort of thrilling idea of the obsolescence of racism. And yet, there's a word of advice printed at the bottom of the Green Book. I'll go back to it. It's an exclamation of both caution and wonder. Carry your Green Book with you. You may need it. Phyllis Wheatley was the first Black woman published in America. In fact, Wheatley's poetry was published before the idea of America had coalesced into reality. As a young girl, Wheatley demonstrated precociousness. At age 11, this girl was already well-versed in Greek tragedy, English plays, and the Vulgate. She had grasped a sophisticated understanding of European history and cartography just a couple of years after she learned to speak English. She took two religious texts in particular, influenced by clerics like George Whitefield and poetry by Alexander Pope. Her first poem, On Misters Hussey and Coffin, was published in the Newport Mercury in 1767, when she was just 13 years old. By the time she was in her early 20s, she had gained patronage from royals in England, so she was really important. She corresponded with contemporaries like John Newton and Thomas Paine. Her first volume of poetry, Poems on Various Subjects, Religious and Moral, was published in London in 1773. In 1776, which was an important year, Wheatley visited with George Washington. He marveled at her. He sensed a sort of intellectual and elegiac kinship with this girl. Their encounter seems to have sent Wheatley herself into a swoon. She wrote a poem about the man, and in the poem, she addresses him as His Excellency, George Washington. So this is one of Phyllis Wheatley's poems. It's probably her most famous. We can think of this poem as a sort of ecstatic hymn to transit, and it's called On Being Brought from Africa to America. 'Twas mercy brought me from my pagan land, taught my benighted soul to understand that there's a God, that there's a Savior too. In this verse, Wheatley is obviously practicing fervent Christianity that was absolutely appropriate for the time. She metabolizes the rhetoric of her new geography, which was a forced geography, and through that issues a missive of subjugation that is a lot more ambiguous than it sounds, I think. I'd like to argue that she's attempting to reconjure her biography. There's no other way for her to do it, right? She can't get back to Africa. She also has no desire to do that. She calls her blackness benighted. She calls her race the color of sable. In this poem, Phyllis Wheatley is contextualizing the sensation of placelessness within the practice of Christianity. So if it's not clear by now, Phyllis Wheatley was a slave. It should be obvious by now that the peculiarity of her story is not that she was even literate. It's peculiar because she was a slave who was literate. The etymology of her name stirs a feeling of brutal grace. This is the case for most black names in America after slavery. There is the formal meaning derived from the old language from which it came, maybe Welsh. And then there's a logistical one, the name that explains the journey to identity. Wheatley received her name when she was sold off to a wealthy family in Boston in 1761. She was 8 years old. The Wheatley family gave her their surname, as you did with all kinds of property. For her first name, the wife, Susanna, chose the slave ship on which she'd been exported to Massachusetts from West Africa, the Phyllis. So Phyllis Wheatley was literally named after the ship that brought her to her new life. Now, as Sadia Hartman examines in her essay, Venus in Two Acts, the travel across the Atlantic cut off many tongues. There is an archive that does not exist because it is at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean. And the ocean reminds us over and over again as we travel across it in new ways on planes that the archive cannot be retrieved. Wheatley's poetry, I think, dramatizes the effort of rememory before that idea existed in America. There's a very strong spiritual exertion that requires her to imagine the travel from her quote-unquote pagan land, Africa, to this new place of Boston, Massachusetts. Here is an interlude in honor of the collusion of scientific racism with Enlightenment thinking. Drapetomania, as it was invented by Samuel Whitefield, who was a doctor in the 19th century, is the condition or the disease that causes Negroes to run. And then this is what this doctor said about drapetomania. It is unknown to our medical authorities, although its diagnostic symptom, the absconding from service, is well known to our planters and overseers. In noticing a disease not heretofore classed among the long list of maladies that man is subject to, it was necessary to have a new term to express it. And this is the term that they come up with. So this painting, which is at the Brooklyn Museum by Eastman Johnson, who was a genre painter in the 19th century, shows a trio of slaves escaping from slavery. And it's called A Ride for Liberty. And if this doctor could have gotten his hands on them, he would have diagnosed them with drapetomania. I'd like to go back a bit earlier in history while also saying that this time is immemorial. Queen Nanny of the Maroons. There's a graphic and really triumphant folktale about Queen Nanny, who's also known as the mother of all Jamaicans. So this is how the story goes. She was leading her tribe of Maroons, which were people who had escaped and were running away from slavery. She was leading them through the Blue Mountains of Jamaica. And while doing so, British soldiers gave chase. They started shooting at this group of Maroons. Queen Nanny caught the bullets in her ass cheeks and ricocheted them back in the direction of the British and escaped. This legend clues us into her brilliance as a guerrilla tactician. Queen Nanny had been sold into slavery at a British plantation near St. Thomas Parish in southeastern Jamaica, along with her brothers. She had escaped into the Blue Mountains. Up until her death, Queen Nanny lived as a fugitive, and she built maroon settlements across the island. She also conducted dozens of successful raids on British sugarcane plantations, often destroying property as she bid the enslaved to come with her. She also killed a lot of white guys. She freed more than 1,000. Queen Nanny was eventually killed in 1733, or around that time, by a British captain named William Cuffy. 6 years later, Queen Nanny's brother Cujo signed a treaty with the British government, agreeing to cease the raids in exchange for 5 settlements, including Nannytown in the Blue Mountains. The reason I wanted to talk about Queen Nanny at this point in the talk is because I want to introduce the idea of maronage. So Fred Moten, who I'll discuss in just a bit, talks about maronage quite frequently. Maronage is obviously the physical act of claiming another landscape as a free home for people who had been formerly enslaved. But it also, if we think of it in a literary context, is a sort of creativity. Creativity of strategy, of course, knowing that you should grab the bullets in your ass cheeks and throwing them back at the soldiers who are chasing you is a very creative stratagem for a warrior. But I think it also suggests a creativity of self. Maronage, if we were to practice it in our everyday lives, imagines, charts, and then creates environments out of already existing environments. And it's all buttressed by this idea that Samuel Whitefield had in the 19th century, that maybe black people were drapetomaniacs, that maybe the idea of rebellion is inborn, it's in the blood, and that no amount of conditioning can extract one's natural propensity towards freedom. The condition of being a maroon or becoming marooned requires balancing a vision of a black utopia with knowing how to get to it, with having a strategy of survival. Now this slide has a quote from Toni Morrison from her essay Playing in the Dark, which was a series of essays, lectures actually, that were turned into essays. And they're really wonderful literary analysis in which she charts the dark and abiding Africanist presence in American literature. It is a dark abiding presence, there for the literary imagination as both a visible and invisible mediating force. And then this quote from Fred Moten, who I had mentioned earlier. Fugitivity is imminent to the thing, but is manifest transversely. And that's from the Undercommons, Fugitive Planning and Black Study. I place these quotes above Gone and historical romance as it occurred between the dusky thighs of one young negress and her heart. This is by Kara Walker. This panorama was mounted at the Drawing Center in Soho in 1994. I recently spent the past month having a continual conversation with Kara Walker for a piece that I was writing for a magazine. And I kept asking her, as many people in this room know, how she has been able to negotiate the constant stream of quite visceral critique that she's gotten from predominantly black artists, and many of those black artists are of the generation before her. And she has so many interesting answers, some that I'll be able to summarize here. Kara Walker, I think, is a fugitive of history. She's able to, especially as we see in this panorama, Gone, go into the interior rooms of those mansions, of those plantations that have been raised or have been reappropriated for post-Reconstruction purposes. She's able to exhume those mansions of their stories and show them in quite lurid yet romantic Harlequin landscapes. And I think the practice of Kara Walker, especially at the time that it came, which was in the 90s, at the turn of post-blackness, at the turn of post-modernism, opens up for us the idea that a black person might be able to reach into history without an agenda. There is a very strong current within interracial black communities that the images of positive blackness are to be curated or to be thrust into the public before those images of ambiguous blackness. And Kara Walker, I think, sort of undergirds the second part of this talk that I'm getting into, which is how can we reappropriate environments to tell our stories? This is June Jordan. June Jordan was a professor, a poet, a cultural critic, an architect, and a foremother of the racial environmental justice movement. She published 27 books in her lifetime, and one of these is right here. It's called His Own Wear, and that was a young adult book that was published in the 1970s. This book was written entirely in African-American vernacular English, and it quite upset some of the more established guard in the black literary world. The genres that June Jordan worked in range from poetry to criticism to fiction to what Toni Morrison called political journalism. In her poems, Jordan was often directed by desire, to borrow the title from one of her collections. She wrote sparse structural odes to sensuality in the ghettos. In that sense, Jordan's sense of the range of her intellectual geography was wide and unbridled. But her freedom was bogged down by the usual things. She didn't always have money. She was raising a young black man in New York City. Eventually, her environment, which was also her muse, entered and compromised her body, giving her cancer. June Jordan, one of this country's most underread public intellectuals, died too young in 2002. Along with other black female poets and intellectuals, including Alice Walker, June Jordan sought to complete the psychic travel that Phyllis Wheatley initiated. June Jordan wrote this essay called The Difficult Miracle of Black Poetry in America. And in that, she offers to Phyllis Wheatley a generosity of spirit that she never would have experienced in her lifetime. She tries to understand why this young black slave would feel such home and solace in Christianity, which of course had been the source of hostility in this hemisphere. And this is what June Jordan writes. It was not natural, but she was the first, Phyllis Wheatley. Come from a country of many tongues tortured by rupture, by theft, by travel, like mismatched clothing packed down into the cargo hold of evil ships sailing, irreversible, into slavery. June Jordan was also an architect. She did a lot in her life. In the 60s, she went to the American Academy of Rome, and there she was particularly fascinated with one structure, and that was the shape of the cone. Jordan was obsessed with it because it neither began nor ended. At the time, this is in the 60s, two life-changing events encouraged Jordan, who had been a native Brooklynite, to redesign Harlem. There were the riots of 1964 and the birth of her only son, that black boy, Christopher. She was a young, worried black mother. Jordan, in collaboration with her mentor, the futurist architect and engineer Buckminster Fuller, who was also called Bucky, she translated her critical theories about the effect of space on families, place, and mood into a blueprint for a new Harlem. And this is the blueprint right here. She planned green space. She sketched longer roads. She lifted earthbound apartment complexes into the sky and put them in these wide cylindrical towers that you see there. The idea was, by lifting, literally lifting where people lived day to day, the environment could also lift the community psyche out of depression or out of all of those, out of all of the moods that black people were experiencing at this time. June Jordan's plan, it was called A Skyrise for Harlem, rid the area of corners. So I don't know if you can see it there, but there aren't any corners in her idea of Harlem, her fantasy of Harlem. And that makes a lot of sense. At that time, and still to today, corners are associated with criminalized activities, so drug dealing, or people who hang out on the corner because of inadequate housing, or the women and men and gender nonconforming people who stand on corners to enter sexual transactions. And instead of corners, June Jordan introduced curvature, because for her, the experience of a black person walking and continuing to walk and meeting no roadblock and meeting no corner would have inspired in them the creativity 150 years of subjugation had stamped out. We know that she was never allowed to apply her plan to the geography in which she lived. In fact, when this plan was published in Esquire magazine during the 60s, the magazine totally took her name off of it and just put Bucky Fuller's. And by taking her name off of the blueprint, it effaced both her genius, but also her psychogeographic perspective about the lay of the land. But still, looking at Jordan's plan now, we can see how environment inspires mood. We can also see how environment can expand possibilities of literal physical movement and behaviors as much as it might foreclose these possibilities. And this, of course, is the racialized ideology baked into the makeup of our city grids. It informs redlining, the ghettoization of predominantly black and brown communities, the highway system, the metro system. This is a quote from Wandering, Philosophical Performances of Racial and Sexual Freedom by Sarah Jane Kasternak. Now, in this chapter, Kasternak is reading a novel by Gail Jones, and the novel is called Mosquito. And there's a character in it who is a black female driver, as you'll see. She says, "As a listener, I wonder what the relationship might be between a 21st century black female driver and a 19th century itinerant anti-slavery and perfectionist preacher. It is often not Sojourner Truth, but Tubman, who tends to be associated with a pro-fugitive movement, namely the Underground Railroad. The Underground Railroad, as a sort of analog to all of the little escapes and the small exits a 21st century black female driver might make, makes a lot of sense. Of course, Colson Whitehead's book came out this last year. The book is going to be turned into a TV show for Amazon in just a bit by Barry Jenkins will be doing the adaptation. And I find this quote provocative because the Underground Railroad has entered the space of mythology, right? When students learn about it in school, they have no way of actually understanding how it worked. It's just that Tubman, who was this magical woman, that's often the tenor with which she's discussed, was able to transfer all of these slaves out of their condition via a strange network of exits and escapes. And so what would an underground railroad look like in this 21st century? How would a black woman as a participant and also a subject of capitalist action find her small escapes and her small exits? You might not find them. So here we talk about fatal movements. This is, of course, Mike Brown and Sandra Bland. There are other photos of Mike Brown and Sandra Bland, as there are also other photos of the ones you might see of Tamir Rice, Trayvon Martin, Rikia Boyd, Eric Garner, and Akai Gurley, the people I mentioned at the beginning of this talk. Those other photos of these American citizens show them dead or in the protracted process of being killed. And they're often prostrate in public places. Mike Brown's body lay in the intersection of a street in Ferguson. Sandra Bland was on a road trip. She was heading to Texas for a new job prospect that she was super excited for when a police officer stopped her. And then a few days later, she was found dead in a jail cell. At this point, it's perhaps useful to think of being black in public as a series of gestures that can become criminalized. At times, these gestures remain unfettered and remain eccentric, and that's the source of black genius. But there are other times, these times, when the physicality of blackness, when black gestures are conceptualized as already disruptive or already violent. And of course, the reason why these gestures, such as walking down a street or driving down to Texas to get a new job, are seen as criminalized is because of the theater of looking, the theater of police looking. It's part of a systemization of how black movement, black gestures are narrated in the greater, wider context, and in both public and private space. Sandra Bland and her car invites us to go back to the Green Book. In the Green Book, they often talk about how much safer it is to travel in America in a vehicle, and in some ways, the accrual of wealth that black people experienced in the 20th century allowed them to get these little shelters that they could go around the country in. And these shelters mitigated the theater of white encounter. However, they're just cars. They're just vehicles. And you can be taken out of them. You can be ripped out of them, in fact. I wanted to end on these photos of Mike Brown and Sandra Bland to interrogate the possibility of new movements for black American citizens. So often, black people are often forced to make the same old movements in our bodies, in our speech, the way we live, because the space for whiteness to see us as safe, if we're unpredictable or quirky or eccentric, barely exists. This is a lesson that children are taught when they're quite young. If you haven't noticed, maybe when you're on public transportation, look at a black child who's wrangled in by his mother for moving away from her on the bus or walking around to see what's going on at the other end of the train. Often she will rein her child back in. And that's not for, you know, the reasons that black mothers are often pathologized. It's not because this black mother wants to prevent her child from experiencing the world. It's that she wants to stop the world from experiencing her child. This is Leslie McSpadden. She's the mother of Michael Brown. This is a still from Lemonade, which is a film that Beyoncé put out last year. The film accompanied her album, also titled Lemonade. And in this still, we can see that McSpadden has her eyes closed. She's possibly crying, and she's holding a photo of Mike Brown, the photo that we saw in the previous slide. The reason that we see McSpadden in that tableau is because Beyoncé invited McSpadden and mothers who have joined this coalition. And the coalition is called Mothers of the Movement. And these are women who have had their sons or their daughters or sometimes even their husbands killed by the state and by the police. Beyoncé invited them to be a part of this utopia that this film Lemonade puts forth. Lemonade struck this incredible mine of creativity in black feminist and black womanist circles on the internet last year. There have been syllabi that have come out that contain all of the writing that black women and also black gender nonconforming people have made about the project. Now this image is of course inspired from Daughters of the Dust, a film by Julie Dash that was that came out 26 years ago, and that was the first feature film by a black woman. So in all the history of film, the first feature came out 26 years ago. Beyoncé puts forth an interesting utopia here. No one's smiling. The sun is setting like in those sunset and those sundown towns. I think the idea of a black feminist utopia that does not detach but rather incorporates all of the discriminations, the infidelities from both the state and also from men and other policing structures that makes those discriminations a part of a better world. I think that's a useful utopia for us going forward. The film begins with Beyoncé looking like Oshun, who is the goddess of birth and destruction, plunging into a pool of water. And here we see her emerging. This water looks familiar. This water might have been the water we played in as children, as girls. This water might have been the water Phyllis Wheatley was transported on when she came to America so many centuries ago. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Doreen, and I would like to now invite our three speakers up for conversation. Those were such all diverse and interesting talks, and you all gave us so much to think about. Thank you. One of the things that I noticed about Andre's and Angela's talks were, well, your talk, Andre, kind of set up Angela perfectly in a way, because you were really both dealing with time. Well, not dealing with time, but everything that you said about the flaneur, needing to have this sort of excess time, you could see that happening. You could sort of see that happening in the World of Warcraft and in the other games that you talked about, where you had to ask people to kind of take a break from the very structured environment that they were in. So the sort of association of the flaneur with a kind of luxuriating in time still, you know, even exists even in the cyber sphere. Mm-hmm. And then yours, Doreen, was very much about space and the sort of the necessity of kind of the right space for wandering and safe wandering and flânerie. I want to just begin with a question for you. Is the flâneur an anti-modern figure?
I didn't see that question coming out of your nice set of observations, Martha. Thank you. Of course he is. Yeah, and yes, the flâneur is a modern figure.
Anti-modern.
Okay.
Yes.
Is the answer to that yes too? yes and no. I think there are. What strikes me, I like the continuities you've drawn up between the three talks, but the differences are also quite striking. Where the 19th century flaneur is such a figure, as I think I said briefly, right, where the activism and the outright critique in the gesture is meant to be very invisible and very subtle, right? And I think this has something to do with Angela's strategies too, of trying to figure out how overtly one has to integrate oneself into the regulatory system one is critiquing. And so mm-hmm. I think they and to that they are both, I think, modern and anti-modern features to it, right? Mm-hmm. In my case, right? Because the invisibility and the hiding, the endless coding that comes with it, right, does sort of lack some of the political outright posturing that we expect of modern critique to entail. And so I think those are some of the more anti-modern features of the 19th century flâneur that I think the 20th and 20th century have almost fully left behind, right, and have become much more of a fully vocal activist kind of approach. Right? That's mm-hmm. Does that get somewhere close mm-hmm. to an answer to mm-hmm. that problem?
Your talk, Doreen, just made me so aware of my own privilege and how I don't even have to, I have to think about being safe as a woman, but I don't have to really think about being out in space and being under suspicion automatically or, you know, sort of being criminalized. So it's just sort of interesting that in some ways flânerie is about, it's like the ultimate freedom, but it's also, terrifying.
Yeah, I hope to at least elucidate the ways that the absence of the possibility of a full and free flânerie for Black women and Black people can at least allow covert or subverted ways of going through the cities or even reimagining the cities as June Jordan did, which I think is important to understand. Of course, it does not feel good to walk around a city or any kind of municipality and feel that you're being surveilled or being policed, but it also offers, by necessity, some fugitive ways of living in America, and therefore it allows these communities to uphold the integrities of their communities, to uphold certain codes and languages that they, of course, don't want to have read by outsiders, by the police, or by the state.
Is it about creating new spaces, or is it about changing your gestures and behaviors to be placate?
Reappropriation.
Okay.
Appropriation of an appropriation, mm-hmm. which is to say Black bodies obviously became capital many centuries ago, given the atrocities of this hemisphere. But what happens if these bodies are able to not retrieve, because that isn't possible, but reimagine what they would have been like prior to that intervention of history and prior to that intervention of capitalism?
Mm-hmm. I want to open it up to the audience in a minute, but first give the three of you a chance to ask each other questions if you have them.
Oh, I wasn't anticipating this.
Sorry, I didn't mean to put you on the spot. If you don't, we can just.
I just want to say that I was just so blown away by your talk, and that I think.
Can you speak up a little bit?
Sorry, yeah, having space for talking about who doesn't get to be a flâneur and why, and a deep history of that was, for me, very moving. So I feel like I can't formulate a question because I'm still
I actually have a question for you. Okay. I was wondering. But thank you so much. I really appreciate that. Has your positioning now as an ethnographer of this world troubled the way gamers interact with you when you're playing? Are they suspicious of you? Or are they worried of you?
I think it depends on what game and what I'm doing and how. Like, I think with the Council on Gender Sensitivity and Behavioral Awareness in World of Warcraft, I think when people hear that that's what it is in the space, initially there's sort of like a, oh, I see what you're doing, like, this doesn't belong here, people throwing. It's hard to really show that experience in a limited context like this, but there's, you know, there'll be people throwing fireballs on top of us and really like trying to disrupt it at first. And then what I quickly realized was that instead of saying that that was like an unacceptable action in this context, I said, oh, this is great. Like, I wanna like hear from you. And this avatar environment facilitates that in a way that's safe, whereas there are other spaces where that's certainly not space, even online, or is not safe, even online. And I think that that willingness as a facilitator in that space to be able to incorporate even those who I clearly don't agree with was a, I guess, a necessity to the continuation of that project, and also made it clear that sort of disruption wasn't going to affect the conversation from continuing, whether or not they wanted to do that. Like, they could keep doing it just wasn't going to affect the conversation from ever going away. But in other spaces, it's definitely been harder to do that, especially spaces that don't have that sort of anonymity. Even though I share the name of the project and people can sort of trace back to me in the space, I had a lot of issues with a particular pickup artist community that I kind of approached with the same process initially with some success, but then ultimately becoming so vulnerable that I couldn't sort of continue because of the way that it was translated through, in some ways, news media that I didn't have control over. So the anonymity in the space, I think, also protects me as a facilitator from some of the highly mobilized, more aggressive behavior that you might know about from things like Gamergate and stuff like that. Yeah. So I hope I answered that okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, Angela, I was thinking of asking you, again, both of your contributions so inspiring. what you're the infiltration of ideology into this fantasy computing world, would you say this is part of the computing world or part of the world of fantasy? So rather than, would this apply also to sort of other fantastical worlds that are non-computerized and on the internet? So much of what you described in my field would have been a beautiful description of Wagner's anti-Semitism or so, mm-hmm. right? And sort of the ring, and you're sitting there for 6 hours, and all these mythical figures, right? And this immense creativity also harbors this endless set of anti-Semitic rhetoric, right? And mm-hmm. so I'm just wondering again if the system you're describing is follows the logic of the internet and the computer, or if it follows the logic of fantasy. Obviously, it does both, right? But where's maybe the priority or the difference between the two?
I mean, I think the way that it functions, and certainly more people are invested in the lore of World of Warcraft, so the storytelling, the fantasy. But I think as it's like functionally grown, it's, you know, it's old now. It's like it's not a bright new shiny game. It's, you know, over 10 years old. So over time, I think that the fantasy has really been subdued, and the developers seem, although certainly they create these expansions and the game continues being built to keep people playing, but over time, the keep people playing part structurally has really become much more important than the fantasy, at least in the way that participants are engaging with it. So I think that structurally, what for me it becomes like a sort of social space where you're just constantly clicking, constantly like being provoked to continue logging on, being given quests that's like, if you log on tomorrow, we'll give you more stuff, almost like, you know, cow clicker or something like that. You know, like it's masked in the form of a fantasy game, and I think that's also why this sort of space to project all of these issues outside of the space is possible, because it's not as it's not like a linear game in the sense of that we might think about when we imagine video games, if we're not very familiar with them, right? Like video games, you do A, you go to that cave, you get that thing, and then, you know, you progress in this sort of linear way. And World of Warcraft's not like that. It's much more of an sort of open world where in the beginning you're given some guidance, and then there's a lot more tasks that are less related to the lore so much. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think that the fantasy part of it really has become less important, at least to the continued player base.
One way I think that something that all three talks brought out is that you can think of Flannery as a kind of type of resistance to attempts to control the body.
Can I ask a question?
Please. Yes.
So the narrative arc is very different in the case. That is, Flannery is not a resistant action as it was presented to a standardization of time. Standardization of time that closes that down. There's a reversal in a certain sense, and I'm wondering, so where is resistance, you know, in your model, Andre? So that was my comment, and I also wanted to say in response to your question to Angela that obviously the kind of fantasy you're dealing with is a participatory group fantasy. There's a social dimension to it that we don't find being an audience member in Wagner. I mean, obviously there are people who fetishize the ring and subcultures that get built up around that, but not people performing the ring in their houses, presumably, I would hope. I'm wondering if this is a 19th century, 21st century division, or because there are certain forms of decadence, for instance, in the late 19th century, that would have the kind of status that fugitivity has for you, or the misplaying has for you.
Mm-hmm.
those are a great, great set of questions, Kaja. Let me start with the first one about where resistance lies, and I think then I'll slowly move to the other ones. I think the Flaneur was a figure of resistance up until a certain point. Then maybe others emerged and took over, like the more dandified aesthete, the gawker that Bridget will talk about later on. And so they're you know, obviously not a strategy of resistance, like the Flaneur isn't effective throughout time, right? I think it had its sort of 40, 50 year effectiveness. I think then it was submerged, and I think now in later periods came back. And I think that's partly because the Flaneur's subtlety and invisible was such a marked difference to the 19th century's real revolutionary communist sort of to the arms kind of upheaval, right? Of real sort of street violence in against which the subtlety of the gesture actually operated on a different level of critique, right? And as soon as sort of that democratic revolutionary practice subsided, I think then the Flaneur and other figures could step up a bit more in their forms of street intervention and so on, which didn't have that sort of specter of opposition associated with them anymore. So I think those are the kind of, I think we have to see a kind of history, political activism, and the strategies in a bit of a lockstep dance here, trying to interrelate each other's effectiveness.
Questions from?
Can I maybe follow up on that?
Okay, then we'll get back.
And maybe like I'll try to pose this initially as a question for Andre, but I think it has implications for the panel as a whole. And I mean, obviously, I think you create this really elegant model, you know, where a rationalized capitalist time kind of squeezes out the heterochronias, you know, of an earlier modern regime. But you know, I wonder whether the thinking isn't dialectical enough, because you know, you create this totalizing model, but of course, you know, capitalist development is always uneven, right? It never imposes itself uniformly across all spaces or presumably all times. And so I think the question for resistance becomes finding where those regimes create areas of underdeveloped time. Maybe that might be one way of considering it. And one way of searching for those areas of resistance, you know? And I mean, okay, now I'm gonna fudge my like bridge thing, because I'm gonna move from a temporal mode back to a more spatial one. Because it seems to me one of the things we could begin to look at is not simply the great, you know, mass workers movements that you talk about of the 19th century, but these stranger phenomena. You know, what was, you know, for a white supremacist medical community, drapedomania, but which, you know, a subaltern community might call fugitivity. You know, or we could think about the strange plague of automatisme ambulatoire, these strange working class wanderers who, you know, unconsciously are moving through the city as kind of latter-day vagabonds that, you know, early psychology becomes fascinated with in the 1880s, 1890s in France. You know, can we begin to find these classed, gendered, raced, alternate times and spaces that are in some ways the very products of the rationalizing regime you talk about?
Tom, thank you. Absolutely, right? One could do that, that would be an absolutely fascinating project to find in all the kind of literary Proust, in the, all the other forms of sort of subtle intervention against this regime, right? Which in part comes also to the fore in the really fraught and long and extensive global spread of universal time, which is not at all even, but very haphazard and resisted in very particular pockets around the world. So this does take 50 or so years, and obviously I never meant to suggest that universal time comes about and it sort of sits down on the throne of time and never ever can be undermined or subsisted in any form, right, in all these ways, gendered, ethnic, in which you described, it can, right? But I think there is also what I wanted to get at was sort of a larger shift here in temporal conception, right? And once that really fundamentally the heterochronomy of the previous time had been subsumed into this more standard form, right? There are just other forms of resistance to it needed to emerge than the flaneur, right? That flaneurial flowing just was not going to do it, right? And so that doesn't mean, that's all I wanted to point out, right? Obviously that then brought all forms of other kinds of resistance to the fore, but not the flaneurial kind, right? The flaneurial kind died. And I think I will stick with that proposition.
I have two brief responses to that, if that's okay. And just maybe it's just that they made me think of things but aren't entirely directly related, but that I guess I didn't mention, it's important for me to say that if you don't know this about World of Warcraft, like, people are logging on for 14 hours at a time. People are already on for that much time. And so for me to ask them to rethink how they're spending that time shouldn't be as radical as it kind of is in that space when people are already committing that kind of time. And then there's still, like, when people do commit to shifting the way that they're going to spend their time and going on these sort of psychogeographical games with me, there are still things that happen where my identity undermines the possibilities of what we can do together. Like, if I'm spending a couple of hours with someone and we're having a great time, and then all of a sudden I'm being asked to, like, give my Skype information and take this off to another space and undergo a sexual exchange with this person now because I put 2 hours with them. Like, it's clear that they're special and I want to spend time that way. So I think that, I don't know, in forms of thinking about how these things can sort of even break down when I have this, I don't know, model of performing as a flaneur in this way. Just wanted to mention that.
This is working, but thank you all so much for these absolutely fascinating, stimulating talks that I thought the progression of which was so perfectly timed, Martha. Not just this progression from time to space, of course, Andre brought out the very nature of being on time as being both spatialized and temporal, so that progression, but also to me a progression along the lines of the morality and the political morality of the figure of the flaneur. I left Andre's talk feeling like the flaneur in his, you know, to use Kant's phrase, purposiveness without purpose, to use Agamben, means without end, is an idealized figure of resistance or of, you know, something we should aspire to in terms of freedom. But then when we got to Angela's talk, there was both, you know, you were pointing to both this exciting discovery of new terrain when you were leading people into moments of beauty as they were adopting this flaneur model, but then also the flip side was the total chaos of freedom in the Sims game. And then, of course, Doreen pointing to really flipping our view of the flaneur, not just as someone who sees, but as someone who is seen, and really flipping for me this notion of the fugitive, which for the 19th century is the definition of the modern. Of course, Baudelaire, that by modernity I mean the ephemeral, the fugitive, and then taking that into a completely new context. So for me, the parallels were just extraordinary. But my question is for Professor Dombrowski. My question's very simple, but I'm going to complicate it as always. I love that you drew out these competing temporal modes, as you say. That's actually working. based on mechanization and the flaneur, these two sort of separate modalities that are, you know, the instant on the one hand, more durational looking on the other hand, visual accidents on the one hand, willful looking on the other hand, distraction versus attention, and then to just continue up the point that was brought before, this notion of the crowd and looking to Le Bon as the crowd as an automaton versus the flaneur as Martha says, representing total freedom. So we have these sort of all these contradictions in these two modalities. And so my question is, the title of this exhibition is Person of the Crowd. So my question is the flaneur ever a person of the crowd, or is the flaneur a figure, person outside the crowd?
Well, the position is ambivalent, right? And meant to be ambivalent here, right? As the person of the crowd, right? There you have, and the man of the crowd in the initial Poean formulation, you have both entities present, right? So it's this continual struggle, and I'm sure Bridget will talk much more about this, right? And has written a beautiful book about the struggle in the modern age between the individual and the individual's ego coming into being and mapping itself over the social world and the urban world, right? And while that happens, there are also certain solidarities formed along the way of artistic groupings, of social groupings, of political groupings, of which that individual had to fit into while preserving a form of individual expression. So I think the characteristic here is to keep both of those elements absolutely alive and intention and in this beautiful dialectic dance, because they're both necessary and both deeply modern forms of engagement, right? The individual and the social collectivity. So I think the flaneur becomes the figure of early on, the figure who can negotiate those two boundaries beautifully, right? And sort of manages to do both, to be himself, herself in the crowd, right? And so it's that what fascinates people. And then I think slowly, as the crowd becomes ever more an important political entity and so on, the balance shift and so on, and the power of the figure shifts and dissipates, I think, a bit. But yeah, central question of the exhibition and the talks we've given. Good pointing them out, yeah.
Thank you all so much. I have an observation of a connection between Angela and Doreen's talks, and would love for you to comment. It's just sort of an observation. So you both brought up psychogeography in interesting ways, and I was really interested in the synergy between what you were describing, Doreen, about June Jordan's concept of a new Harlem and really putting to the fore a concept of elevation and curvature as part of that urban infrastructure model. And I saw that happening in Angela's approach to the World of Warcraft, when you would kind of allow yourself to drift in this new psychogeographical realm, and you would fly, and you would engage in elevation, and you would engage in circuitous routes. So I'm just wondering if you guys have any thoughts about that commonality and that kind of type of approach to space in this mode.
I think it's something I definitely was very excited watching your talk. I was anticipating the polarization of that idea, given that we were examining two completely different environments. And so I think with regards to Jordan's plan in Harlem and New York City, one of the most gridded cities in America, the idea is that the curvature would absolutely obliterate the straight lines of the city. It's very rare that you find a curved block in New York City or in any of the boroughs inside of it. And so I think essentially my guess is that that would be to approximate the sensation of walking in nature, of walking in of walking in the place before the place became gridded or before it became lined. But of course, ultimately, in order to impose that on a small region of land or a small area that contains a very particular population of people, that would of course destroy the entire city as we conceive of it. You can't just create a circle full of interior circles in New York City, because of course in the 19th century all of American cities began to, you know, get these grids. A boulevard from Paris becomes a sidewalk in New York City. And so I think I totally agree with that observation. I think that the prevalence of curvature for her was meant to inspire in the walkers and inspire in the citizens a lack of stoppage, to never feel like they had to stop walking, to never feel like they had to be controlled by a stoplight or by the intrusion or introduction of a store, that there would always be another destination, and therefore they would continue past the prescribed expectations that the city and the government and the state had for them.
In WoW, like, one of the things that I was first attracted to when I started playing it was how like vast the space was compared to any other game that had come before it. How many details there were that were unnecessary. How like that waterfall that I fly up in the one video that I showed in the beginning. I was like, how come nothing has ever pointed me to go to this place? It looks amazing. So then I went up to the top and I'm like, there's literally no reason to be here, but I'm here. And it's like the best view I've ever seen in this, you know. And I just was doing this so much and talking to the first acts of the psychogeographical projects. I was just asking people what their favorite places were in WoW, like where is something interesting that I should know about? And so many people were just like, I don't look at it. Like what? And I was like, how do you not look at it? Because so much of the early days of the game was leveling so that you could get the, you know, thing that you could ride on the horse, or the, you know, variations of horses. And being able to move faster and farther, and then being able to fly, you know, you can't do that until in the beginning at level 60, which took a really long time. So finally, like the original structure of the game was built up to allow you to expand your understanding of the space over time, like babies do or something. but what they did over time was sort of break that down so that people didn't have to spend the time flying, to really accommodate lifetime players who just wanted to sort of like get new cool gear and not have to actually ever like see much of the space. So now you don't have to fly at all anymore, really. And that I think also, like, over the time of the project, as that sort of started being minimized, it seemed more and more important for me to spend time in the space that way. And yeah, a lot of players commented like, oh, I knew you were a woman because you were interested in spending your time this way in this space, and you must not be really a real gamer.
Wow.
Because it's not, you know, it's not natural for gamers to want to do this. So
not efficient.
Yeah, it's not efficient. You're not like leveling fast enough. You're not getting the new gear and so on. So I think that became more and more clear to me that these two projects were more related than I originally thought.
So because we are all controlled by the clock, I think we could do one more quick question, and then we're going to take a break. Tom, sorry, I'm playing favorites. Tom.
When it's your house.
So, but as a discipline of my own, this is a question for Doreen. Phyllis Wheatley did something incredibly profound with the psychogeography of the Middle Passage in that little fragment of poetry that you presented. And then you did something, I think, equally extraordinary in the way that you extrapolated from that an idea about psychogeography and the way in which it might be completely reconceived around related issues. And I'm just wondering if you could unpack that a little bit, because I'll be thinking about it for a long time.
Yeah, I mean, I think, like many people, I've been absolutely floored and inspired by the work of Hartman, Thea Hartman, which is why I cited Venus in two acts at that point in the talk. And that is to say, of course, the possibility of failure just buzzes around you when you look at Phyllis Wheatley's poetry from centuries ago, when you have absolutely no sense of her story outside of the interpretations or the publications that happened in newspapers, or her meetings with George Washington, or her correspondences with royals from England. And so it's a very intrusive practice, I think, to anachronistically read this poem and to sort of imbue it with the intention that might have been lurking under her outwardly intellectual project, right? And her project was obviously to contextualize the flight, the forced flight of Africans to America as a sort of reverse exodus story. That's what she's doing in so much of her poetry, and ironically what she wasn't, I think, able to complete because she died penniless, like most women artists do. So I think the work that June Jordan and Alice Walker and all of the black women who were writing at the end of the first introduction of womanism, so that would be the late 70s, early 80s, the work that they've done to sort of like reconstitute the person who was Phyllis Wheatley very much inspired me when it came to my reading of the poem. And like I said, The Difficult Miracle of Poetry in America, that essay by June Jordan, also does that, and it does that at length. It looks at no archive, no record, only what is underneath the words, only what is lurking underneath the poetry of Phyllis Wheatley to deliver an idea or an approximation of her psyche. And of course, I want to totally emphasize that failure is part of this process of anachronistic looking. We'll have no idea what her true record was, but because of the lack of the archive, we are absolutely indebted to the work that Phyllis Wheatley has done in terms of opening a lane for black female writers in this country. We have to imagine it. We have to attempt to reconstitute it, even if in that reconstitution we might be aberrant.
So, thank you. We are going to take a break now to have lunch, and you have time to check out the exhibition if you haven't already. We'll reconvene at 1:45, so since we're running a little bit late. The program says 1:30, but we'll start at 1:45. Thank you for three brilliant talks.